We'll just continue where we were last time, and I review a little bit more about the profiles. Okay, just to begin. So this is still from last time, okay? So it's the same, I didn't change. So we have a bounded sequence, and for each J we have solutions of the linear wave equation, and we have a sequence of parameters. So the lambdas are the scaling parameters, the x's are the translation parameters, and the t are the time translation parameters. And I'm not entirely consistent in how I write this. So sometimes the j's go on top, sometimes they go on the bottom, sometimes the n comes first, sometimes the j comes first. So anyway, from the context, it should be clear. Okay, and we call this sequence of triples orthogonal. Sometimes we say it's almost orthogonal if these ratios have the property that their sum goes to infinity, so that means that at least one of them goes to infinity. Okay? And if the sequence of parameters is orthogonal, and this is a sequence of solutions of the linear wave equation, which we then modulate according to these triples, and we find this thing, and then we look at the difference between the linear solution corresponding to our given sequence and the sums of the profiles, modulated, then this error has to, first of all, remain uniformly bounded, but also it has to go to zero in the sense of the space-time norm. Okay, so this is the, in the case we were looking at, this is the L8 norm.
I'm slightly confused. The UJL are solutions of the
linear wave equation. Yes.
Okay. But what happens if you take, for instance, a well-localized solution?
Yes.
And you may have a Lorentz boosted bit, that can also occur.
Yes, and that's a...
I'm slightly surprised that you if you have a Lorentz boosted, then you expect it to have x x proportional to t, and then you localize both in x and t.
Yeah, but you can translate in t. You're translating in t, and the other thing is that your Lorentz boosts are limited because they keep the bounded sequence in H1 cross L2.
So the sequence xjn tgn, if it's a Lorentz boosted solution, can be proportional and travel at the appropriate speed.
Yes.
So that's why you include the time translations too. Okay. But the speeds cannot go to 1 because of the uniform bound on the energy norm of U0 and U1n. Okay, so the Lorentz boosts are compactified by that. Okay? And I don't know what happened. This? Oh, I was away from it too long? Do you think I didn't move it for too long, or why do you think, yeah, that's what happened? Okay.
Is it plugged?
Pardon me? Yeah. Yeah, everything seems to be plugged. Okay, so let's keep on going, and then it goes to zero in the L8 norm, but it also goes to zero in most of the other Strickart's norms. And as I was mentioning last time, the only one that it does not go to zero in necessarily is the so-called kill tau endpoint. This actually is false, that it goes to zero in that. In fact, we discovered this recently. Okay. So then there's a remark as to how these UJLs are constructed from the given sequence. You construct them from the given sequence by taking an orthogonal set of parameters and then taking the linear solution at these ratios and then taking weak limits. Okay. That's how these profiles are constructed. And the fact that this object goes weakly in H1 cross L2 to this one is a consequence of the fact that these errors, provided you scale them before the capital J, they all have to go weakly to zero. Okay? Okay, and then I remember we have, from the orthogonality of the parameters, these Pythagorean expansions. Okay? And I mentioned last time, the Pythagorean expansions have to be taken carefully, because if you separate, for instance, they are not true. They may fail. And this was a big surprise for us, but it's true. You have counterexamples to that. But there's this substitute where here the core indices are the ones for which Tjn is identically zero, and the scattering indices are those for which absolute value Tjn over lambda Jn goes to infinity. And so you recover this forbidden Pythagorean expansions, provided you keep together the scattering ones. Okay? But you can separate off the core ones. Okay. One cannot be too overconfident in dealing with these profiles. One has to be extremely careful. Okay? It's very easy to fool oneself. And believe me, we've done this. So, okay. But of course, you could say, okay, you had this Pythagorean expansion, but maybe if you, that didn't work. Maybe if you chose a different profile decomposition, it could have worked. And the answer to that is no, because there's a certain uniqueness. Okay. So the first statement is that if you change the parameters in such a way that this limit exists and is non-zero, and this limit exists, and this other limit exists, then you get in and you renormalize your profiles by this recipe, you do get a new profile decomposition. But then there's a result that says that this is the only way to get a different profile decomposition. And it's using this kind of transformations that you can always reduce these parameters Tjn to be either identically zero or such that the absolute value of Tjn over lambda Jn tends to infinity. Okay, those are the three options. Yes.
When you are comparing the two, you have to make a further subsequent extraction?
Yes, yes. So we never blink at taking further subsequent extractions. We don't even think about it. We automatically extract, okay? Okay, so this is the uniqueness result. And now there's another remark that says that whenever you have a sequence and this thing has a weak limit, this arises as a profile, possibly after some of the transformations that we had before. Okay, so all such weak limits arise as profiles. Okay. So the next thing that I want to say is I want to discuss how do we use this for nonlinear problems. Because up to now, we've only been dealing with linear profiles and linear solutions. And in order to use this in the nonlinear situation, we introduced the notion of nonlinear profile. And remember last time I was talking about decompositions into blocks. The blocks are the nonlinear profiles. Okay, that's the technical thing. And what is a nonlinear profile? Well, we look at the sequence minus tjn lambda jn, and we look at our linear profile evaluated at that sequence of times, and then we find the nonlinear solution such that this limit is zero. Now, these nonlinear profiles always exist because there are two situations. If the tjn or lambda jn has a finite limit, then you just solve a nonlinear wave equation at that finite limit, and then you get this. If it goes to plus infinity, what you do is you solve the equation at infinity. So that's like what they call the existence of the wave operator. Okay, sorry. And so these nonlinear profiles always exist. And again, by extraction, we can always assume that this limit exists. In the case when it is finite, we might as well think that it is zero, because by a time translation and changing the profile, we can take it away. And otherwise, it's plus infinity or minus infinity. Okay. In this formalism, all sequences have limits. Don't tell this to your calculus students, but okay, all sequences have limits.
So if the limit is infinite, then it's a scattering solution?
Yeah, it's like the final state. It's the wave operator. That's all. Okay? And because of this construction, if it's a scattering solution, as Jan says, then you see that if the limit is minus infinity, the time of existence for this nonlinear profile is minus infinity, and the nonlinear solution scatters at minus infinity by construction. And the same at plus infinity. Okay, this is just because you construct it by scattering. Okay. So now we look at the modulated nonlinear solutions. Okay, we can still do that. And of course, the maximal, let's say, positive time of existence of this modulated solution can be obtained from the old one by this formula. It's nothing. This is just arithmetic. And it's plus infinity if this is plus infinity. And so we have this approximation theorem that is a very important tool for us. It tells us that if we have a profile decomposition, and we control all the Strickland's norms of the blocks, then we can write the solution as a sum of the blocks plus a small error. Okay? That's so the first case of this theorem is the easiest to state. It says that if all the solutions, if all the nonlinear profiles scatter forward in time, then our nonlinear solution minus the sum of the nonlinear profiles minus the linear solution associated with the remainders in the profile decomposition actually goes to zero in a very strong sense. Okay? So when I was saying in the first lecture that we look at each block in the nonlinear solution, this is what I meant. We use this kind of decomposition.
So you may have a situation of where some of the profiles have already blown up, but not all, and in between the two, you don't know what happens.
No, so here is what we can say then. Then you can go as far as, in time, as far as all the Strickland's norm remain bounded of the nonlinear profiles. So suppose we take a time theta n such that it's always within the time, the forward time of existence of the UJN. And suppose that up to that time, the Strickland norms remains bounded uniformly in n. then you can still do this. So then the nonlinear solution is defined up to that time. The Stricker's norms remain bounded. We have the sum, and the error goes to zero, but only up to that time, theta n.
But you are not saying anything if the theta n is bigger than the blow time sum of the j, but not of all.
No, I have to be smaller than all the blow up times. Okay? No, otherwise I'd have something that is impossible, so that would be too good to be true. Okay? So a sufficient condition for this is either they all have very small H1 cross L2 norm, the profiles, or all the parameters are scattering. That's another possibility. Or this theta n stays strictly away from the final time of the UJs. And then in this case you can do that. So I have some remarks about the proof. First, this L8 norm can also be taken to be the L5, L10 norm. Those are more or less fungible norms. Now the proof of this theorem uses this thing I described as the long-time perturbation theorem. And it also uses very strongly this kind of orthogonality property for the L8 norm to the eighth of this modulated nonlinear profiles. So this is kind of a Pythagorean expansion for the L8 norm. Okay? So a very important consequence of this approximation theorem is the fact that these Pythagorean expansions that held for the linear profile decomposition also hold for these nonlinear profile expansions up to any time strictly smaller than this theta n. So we have this fact, we have the same thing for the L6 norm, and so on. And this is because morally, well, not morally, in actuality, you can see that if this converges, which you can do after extraction, you can make the nonlinear profile decomposition into a linear profile decomposition. You manufacture the linear profile that corresponds to the appropriate nonlinear profile depending on the parameter Sj. Okay? Okay, so I will not torture you anymore with profiles. This is a kind of a tricky business, but I've put down all the relevant things now. Okay? So now we move on. And what we're going to do is first, there's a number of things about elliptic equations that we need. And so I'll start by developing those. So we need properties of solutions of the elliptic equation and some variational estimates, okay? And that's what we start out with now. So again, this is the associated nonlinear elliptic equation, and we call sigma the non-zero solutions. There's this explicit solution, which is well known from the Yamabe problem. And as I said last time, this is up to translation and scaling the only non-negative solution. And that's the result of Gidas, Nie, and Ehrenberg. And if I don't translate, these are the only radial solutions with a plus and a minus. And this combines work of Bohorzhaev, Gidas, Nie, and Ehrenberg, and Kwong. So Kwong somehow does it for ODE solutions, I mean the radial case. Bohorzhaev reduces to the radial case, and Gidas, Nie, and Ehrenberg gives you some decay properties. Okay, so you have to put all this elliptic machinery together, but the summary is simple. You know, as I was saying last time, sometimes you can summarize in two or three sentences maybe 25 years of work. Okay, but that's okay. It's convenient for us who didn't do the work to just summarize. Okay, so as I was saying last time, this W is also called the ground state. So let's recall the Sobolev inequality in 3D. We're in 3D, if the gradient is in L2, the function is in L6. And there's a best constant, and I will call this best constant C3. Okay? C3 is a known number. It was calculated, I think, by Bliss already. It has pi's and gamma functions and so on, but it's a known quantity. So this C3 is not some positive constant, but a known positive constant. Okay. And one way in which W is extremal is that it gives you equality in this inequality, and modulo scaling and translation is the only non-zero function for which you have equality. Okay, so that's the theorem of Oban and Talenti. Now, let me go back to the elliptic equation. Multiply this by q and integrate by parts. Then you see that the integral of q to the 6 equals the gradient of q squared. Okay? So this is a piece of information that we will use. So, since this is a solution of the nonlinear equation, this holds. And we know that this holds because this is an extremal. So that means that we have a formula for this. Okay, because we have two equations, so we can solve. And this is what you get. The gradient of W squared is this best constant to the power minus 3. Okay, so this is just what. And now we're going to calculate the energy of this W. The formula for the energy is 1/2 gradient minus 1/6 W to the 6. But these two numbers are the same, so it's 1/3 grad W squared. So we know that grad W squared is C3 minus 3 over 3. So this is this, and it's that. Okay?
So this is a point where you heavily use the criticality.
Absolutely, yes. And where you heavily use the variational characterization of the ground state. Now, because of these things, W is the elliptic solution, the non-zero elliptic solution, with the least energy. Okay? So I'm going to now give you a way in which this W is isolated in the set of solutions to the elliptic equation. Okay? So this is a theorem that says that if I have a solution and its L2 norm of the gradient doesn't reach twice the one of W, it can only be W. So to be above W, you have to go up a fixed amount. Okay? So let's prove this. I'll sketch the proof here. It's a simple proof. We define Q plus and Q minus. And then the first observation is Kato's inequality tells you. Kato's inequality tells you that the Laplacian of the positive part of a function is bigger than or equal to the positive part of the Laplacian. Okay? And so in this case, Kato's inequality gives you this. You multiply by q plus again, and you get this inequality. And similarly, you get the corresponding inequality for q minus. And we know that they add up to less than twice the one of W. So one of the two has to be smaller than W, than one. Right? If both are bigger than two, you can't be less than twice. So let's assume that the Q minus is the one that's smaller. We will show that then it has to be zero. Why is that? Because Q minus, by the integration by parts, the gradient is less than the L6 inequality. You use the solvable inequality with the best constant to go to the gradient. Now we use that this number is this, and we get to this. And so now we read off from here that either this number is zero, or I can divide by this number and get this. But this is a contradiction because we started out by assuming that this was less than. Okay? So the assumption that Q minus was not identically zero is absurd. So Q minus is identically zero. If Q minus is identically zero, Q is non-negative. If Q is non-negative, by Gidas Nirenberg, it has to be W. Okay? I think this is a kind of a folklore argument. I don't know where it is in print, but it's a folklore argument. Okay? So it's a fact about the elliptic equation. And as a corollary, you can use this to very simply to show that the if you have a solution whose energy is smaller than the energy of W, then it has to be W. Okay? And it just follows from this, by the elliptic equation, this equals that, and then because of this, you get this, but if you get this, you have to be W, so. All right? And in fact, if you precise this calculation, you see that any other solution has to have energy strictly above the energy of W. There's a gap in the nonlinear spectrum, whatever you want to call that, okay? So now I'm going to use some properties of the ground state, these variational characterizations, to prove some variational estimates that allow me to completely understand the situation as far as the global dynamics, provided the energy is smaller than the energy of W. Okay, so this is what Merrill and I proved, about 10 years ago, okay? Which, in a sense, is the beginning of this story. Okay? So, now we're going to do a little bit of calculus, okay? True one variable calculus. So this variational lemma says that suppose that my gradient is smaller than the gradient of W and its energy is strictly smaller than the energy of W by an amount delta naught. Then there is a block. So we call this energy trapping. It tells you that the gradient, instead of just being smaller, is smaller by a definite amount. Okay? And not only that, but there's a certain coercivity going on. Okay? And in particular, the energy is strictly positive. Or zero, of course. Okay? So let's see the proof of this. As I was saying, the proof is calculus. I'm going to form the following one variable function, 1 half y minus 1 6 c3 to the 6 y cubed. Okay, it's a function of one variable. The first thing I note is that if y bar is the gradient squared, then this is less than the energy. And this is just the fact that C3 is the best constant in the Sobolev inequality. Okay, nothing more than that. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to find the positive zeros of this function. Of course, that involves solving a simple quadratic equation, so we can do that. So for positive y, this is zero, if and only if it is zero, or 3 to the 1/2 grad w squared. So the zeros are at a fixed amount higher than grad w squared. 3 to the 1/2 is strictly bigger than 1. Okay. Then the next thing we're going to find is what the critical points are. Okay. So for the critical points, we differentiate and find the zeros. And it's exactly 1 over C3 cubed, which, if you remember, that's the L2 norm of the gradient of W squared. It's the integral of grad W squared. Okay. And add this, so here it is. And what is the value of f at its critical point? Well, it's exactly 1/3 of C3, and that is the energy of W. So this W appears for this one variable function. So f is non-negative and is strictly increasing before you hit the first critical point, because for y small, it is clearly increasing because we have the power 1 and the power cubed, so on. Okay? But also, this critical point is non-degenerate because you can see that the second derivative will be strictly positive for y positive because it's, you can compute it, it's a cubic polynomial. Okay? So what does that mean? It means that f is strictly increasing up to when I get to the critical value. And at the critical value, I have the value of the energy of W. Now, I'm assuming that I'm a fixed amount below in energy that critical value. That means that f of the gradient is a specific fixed amount below, and therefore the inverse function is a strict amount below the gradient of w squared. And that proves the first part. I'll recall what the first part is. Is that. Right, it's just the monotonicity of f near there. Okay, and you can calculate what this delta bar in terms of this delta is. There's a square root involved. But anyway, it's there. And now we're going to prove the other inequality. And the other inequality comes very simply from the first inequality. So here, we go to here by the Sobolev embedding. Now we take out this common factor. And now we see that C3 to the 6 is the gradient W squared. And then this is smaller than 1 minus delta squared, gradient of W squared. So this and this cancel out, and we get this. And this is strictly positive, because delta bar is positive. Okay? And that's how you get the coercivity. All right. The next thing that I want to point out is that this proof shows that if you are below the first zero of this function little f, your energy has to be positive, because little f is bounded by the energy. And if little f is positive, the energy is positive. And this value was the first zero. So So the energy remains positive a little bit beyond the ball of radius grad W squared. And the amount is 3 to the 1/2. Okay? Okay, so now I need to study some properties of general solutions and their Lorentz transforms. Remember that the traveling wave solutions I claimed were Lorentz transforms. I'm going to prove that now. Okay. So you need a little bit of information about solutions to the elliptic equation. Maybe it'd be good if I write on the board the elliptic equation. That's the elliptic equation, and so elliptic regularity theory immediately gives you that if you have a solution, it will be C infinity. Okay. And this is where lower dimensions are better than very high dimensions here. Q to the 5 is a very nice power, Q to the 7/3 is not so great, but which is what you get in dimension 5, for example. Anyway, so but let's stick to Q to the 5. So Q is C infinity. And the next thing that we're going to see is that Q has decay at infinity. And the decay is the decay of W. W is the one that gives you the slowest decay at infinity. How do you see this? Well, there's a simple way of seeing it, which uses the Kelvin transform. If you remember when you studied harmonic functions, you can do the Kelvin transformation and you still have a harmonic function. In 3D, the Kelvin transform is 1 over length of x, f of x over x squared. Okay? Now it turns out that the Kelvin transform also preserves solutions of the nonlinear elliptic equation. So that equation is invariant under conformal transformations of R3. And the Kelvin transform then does that. And so you can pull infinity to a bounded point by the Kelvin transform. You pull infinity to the origin. And you use that solutions of the nonlinear equation are smooth at the origin. And that gives you this decay. Okay, so that's all there is to it. All right. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to prove a certain identity. The L2 norm of each partial is a third of all the full gradient. So all the partials have the same L2 norm. Of course, for W, this is obvious by the invariance under rotations. But for any other W, you can prove it just by multiplying the equation by this expression. You multiply the equation by this expression. Okay. It seems to be temperamental today, I don't know. Okay? You multiply the equation by this and integrate by parts, and you see that the terms from infinity go away because of the decay estimates. Okay, so that's why I'm stating the decay estimates, and when you unravel that, you get this identity. Okay. And this is something we like. This identity plays a role. Now I take a vector of length less than 1, and I take my q, and I view it as if it were a function of x and t, constant in t, and I do the Lorentz transform of that function in x and t. And then what I in the direction given by L. What I get is this horrendous mess, so don't pay any attention to it. The important thing is that it is a function of this form, x minus t times L. So it's translating, it's being translated in the direction given by L for each t. And what is the function q sub L? What you get by making t equal 0 here. Okay? Okay, so don't look at this too much because it's not going to help. So, but what is interesting is that if we do a rotation in the x variable, we can make this L to be a little L times E1. Okay, that's certainly possible. And these equations are invariant in the rotation, so that's allowable. And little L times E1, when you do the Lorentz transform in the direction given by L times E1, you have a very specific formula that I gave last time, where the x1 goes to x1 minus LT over square root of 1 minus L squared, and the T goes to x, T minus LX1 over the square root of 1 minus L squared. And the X2 and X3 are not touched. Okay? Now this Q, Lorentz transforms of the Q have some interesting properties. Which of course is nothing more than changing variables and chasing everything around. The one thing I want to point out now, though, is that the effect of the Lorentz transform is to make the energy bigger. Okay? And a control on the energy gives you a control of how far L is from 1 by this identity. And remember that this is a positive number for all solutions of the elliptic equation. The energy is strictly, for all non-zero solutions, is strictly positive because it's strictly bigger than the energy of Q, and the energy of Q was 1/3 of the best constant in the solve of inequality to the power of 3 or something like that. Okay? So we saw all these numbers. Okay, so let me show now that all traveling waves are of the form QL for some Q, a solution of the nonlinear elliptic equation. And this is something that we proved in I work with Decaire and Merle. The real proof was done in 2011, but that was not clarified sufficiently in 2014. We have the explicit proof. Okay. So I start with a function f of xt, which is a traveling wave function with f in h1, and suppose that this solves the nonlinear wave equation. Okay, so I have a solitary wave for the nonlinear wave equation. So the claim is that then f has to be q sub l for a q solution to the elliptic equation. All right? And this is important for us because if we're going to do soliton resolution and we want to decompose things into sums of modulated traveling waves, it's a good thing to know what the traveling waves have to be, right? Okay. So this is the point of this calculation. Okay. So again, we can do spatial rotation on this f. This f is a function on R3. So we do a spatial rotation so that L is little l times E1. So then f is of this form. And now I plug in, what does it mean to solve the nonlinear wave equation? And that's this. And you see the 1 minus L squared factor in front of dx1. Okay, and let me assume for this proof, for simplicity, that L is positive. Okay, the case L is negative, it just changes t into minus t, so it's not. Okay? So, but I have this equation. And this proposition says that suppose f is a non-zero function, L is in R, and that equation holds, then necessarily L squared is less than 1, and there's a Q solution of the elliptic equation such that it's the Lorentz transform of that solution. Okay? So the proof goes, there are three different cases. First case is L squared is bigger than 1. If L squared is bigger than 1, this really cannot happen because of finite speed of propagation. So you just have to produce the argument that shows that. And the argument is as follows. I call u of xt this thing, where I'm undoing the lt here. So this is a global in time solution. Its gradient at zero is f, and its t derivative is ld dx1. So because f is in h1, I can find a large m. Given an epsilon, I find a large m such that this is small. So the tails are going to be small at time zero. But if the tails at time zero are small, by finite speed of propagation, I get this propagating into the future. And so if I give up a little bit on the m, I need to give up a little bit to use some cutoff function to be able to use the finite speed of propagation, then I get that for all time t, this is smaller than some constant times epsilon. And the constant comes from this smooth truncation that I have to do. Okay? So once I have that, I look at the compact set in x2 and x3 and two numbers a and b. And the first observation is that if t is large, and I have x1 in this interval and x2 in x3 in this interval, then I know that the length of x has to be bigger than lt. And that's because this l is bigger than 1. Okay, and I'm moving only by t here, by lt. That's one way of using that l is bigger than 1. So once we know that, if I look at this, of course, I have this fact from the finite speed of propagation, but I have my formula for u, and I do changes of variables, and I get that this thing equals that. But so this thing for fixed k and fixed a and b is smaller than c epsilon for every epsilon, so this thing has to be zero, and so f has to be zero. Now the tricky case is when l is one, because then this argument just does not work. And that's where the way you get out of it is you go back to elliptic theory, but you're going to use elliptic theory in R2 instead of in R3. So, because remember that the factor in front of the d dx1 is 1 minus L squared. When L is 1, that factor is 0. So your equation set, your function verifies an equation in two variables instead of in three variables. So my f verifies this equation in these two variables, and it's for almost every x1 has some regularity. So we fix such an f1 and we let f be this, and we'll show that f is zero by using Pohorzhayev's argument. And the idea in Pohorzhayev's argument is that from the equation you get this identity, which you can check by Leibniz rule. And from this identity you integrate by parts. Integrate by parts both sides. If I integrate this side, I get zero because I'm integrating a divergence. And when I integrate this, the only thing that happens is that this falls on this, and that gives me a 4 over 6. There's a 2 from this divergence, a 2 from the formula, and a 6 from there. And so the conclusion is that f to the 6 is 0. If f to the 6 is 0, f is 0, and so that's the case L is less than 1. L is equal to 1. Okay? And to justify the integration by parts, we use a truncation argument. So I won't bother with that. Now, finally, assume that L squared is less than 1, and now I fixed then the first variable problem by doing this. If I do this, now I verify the usual equation from this equation with the 1 minus L squared, and that's the elliptic equation, so F verifies the elliptic equation, and L squared has to be less than 1. So these are the traveling waves. Okay. So let's start now with a proof of this ground state conjecture. So this uses this concentration, compactness, rigidity theorem method. So let me start reminding you of the precise statement of this theorem. Okay, so the precise statement is, suppose we have a solution and its energy is smaller than the energy of W. And let U be the corresponding solution of the nonlinear problem. Okay? Then if the gradient is smaller than the gradient of W, then the solution exists for all times in both time directions and scatters in both directions. And if it is strictly bigger, then it blows up in both time directions. And then you say, okay, you're missing a case, which is this. But it turns out that that case doesn't exist. There's no such function. The energy constraint and this are incompatible. There's no such function.
What about u0 equal over u1 equal 1, 0?
There's strict inequality here. There's strict inequality in the energy. Okay. In fact, the case where energy of U0 equals energy of W0 is a very interesting case that was solved in a paper by Ducaire and Merrill. They classified what happens. And there you have, you either scatter in both time directions, or in this case, you have you scatter in one direction and you go to some new object called W minus in the other direction. And in this case, either you blow up in both time directions or you blow up in one of the time directions, and in the other one you go to another object called W plus. Okay, but I'm not gonna enter into that today. Right, so that is a legitimate case, but it's also understood. Okay. So let's look at this. So there are three things to prove. Okay, and of these three things to prove, the last two are more or less simple consequences of the variational estimates that we had. And the real content is property one. So remember that from the local theory of the Cauchy problem, this condition is equivalent to scattering. Okay? So this is what I would say the hard part of the theorem. Okay? But let me dispose of the other two parts first. And then we will start developing the theory that goes into this. Okay. So to deal with the third point, I will recall another variational estimate, which is quite a useful. It says that if the gradient is less than or equal to the gradient of W and the energy is less than or equal to the energy of W, then the gradient squared is, so a way to say it is that the ratio of the gradient squares is less than the ratio of the energies. Okay? So let's prove that. And we the first thing that I'm going to do is use this claim to show that there cannot be something with energies less than the energy of W and gradient equal to the gradient of W. Okay? Why is that? Because if the gradients are equal, then the ratio of the energy of W and the energy of B divided by the energy of W is bigger than or equal to 1 from this inequality. But it's also strictly less than 1 by assumption. So that's the contradiction. Okay? So this claim immediately gives that third case is not possible. Is that clear? It's just that the ratio of the gradient of V and the gradient of W is 1. So this ratio of energy has to be bigger than or equal to 1, but we know it is less than 1. So, okay? So now let's prove the claim. Again, we use the same function of one variable that we used before, this polynomial of degree 3. And we notice that f of 0 is 0, okay? F of grad W squared is the energy, we already saw that. And f in a gradient is smaller than the energy by the solvable inequality. The next observation is that this f is concave, because its second derivative is negative. Why is it for s positive? Why is it negative? Because it's minus a constant times s. Degree 3 polynomial, so we can check that it's concave. So since it's concave and f of 0 is 0 and f of 1, so I look at f of s grad w squared, that's a concave function. And at 1, it equals the energy of w squared. At 0, it is 0. So the concavity gives me this. So f of grad w squared is bigger than or equal to s times the energy of w comma 0. And now I choose this s. And I plug it in and it gives me precisely the claim. So it's these arguments are very simple calculus arguments. But of course you have to know what to plug in. Okay, so this takes care of 3. Okay. Now I will prove 2, and there is an extra assumption that the U0 is in L2. So 2 says that if the energy is smaller but the gradient is bigger, it will blow up. So I will do it for functions in L2, you can pass to the general case by truncation using finite speed of propagation. So let me just do this case. Okay. So the first thing is that this argument with this function little f, which we first did when the gradient was smaller than the gradient of W, also has a version when you pass the critical point. So when you pass the critical point, the f was increasing, you get to the critical point, and now you start to go down. Okay? So that means that if you start out with the gradient being bigger, it will stay a definite amount bigger. It's the same argument, but on the other side of the critical point. Okay, so this variational estimate tells you that if the energy is smaller by delta naught and it is bigger, then it's a certain amount bigger. So using this is a static argument. Now you can plug it into the hole, into the flow. Okay, the flow preserves the energy. So if I start out with the energy being smaller, it'll continue being smaller. And if the gradient was bigger, it's now bigger by a certain amount. So for a little bit of time, it will still remain big, bigger than the gradient of W. But then I reapply the static argument and I get a fixed amount bigger. And then by continuity of the flow, while the flow is continuous, it will remain strictly bigger. Okay? So it's a continuity argument. So for all t in the maximal interval, this is a certain amount bigger. So the argument that we use for the blow-up is an argument that goes back to work of Harold Levine Anyway, this is from the early 70s. Okay? And it's an argument that's been used for blow-up problems. It's similar to arguments of Zakharov and Glassy for the Schrödinger equation. Okay? All right. So now I am saying that the energy is smaller than the energy of W, and so there's a certain amount delta for which it is still bigger. Since it's strictly bigger, you have room to put in a little bit. And now I solve for the term of u to the 6 in this inequality. And this is what I get. Okay, I put this on the other side, the u to the 6 on this side, and this is what I get. Okay. And now I multiply by 6, and this is what I get. I will actually, in the next slide, multiply this by 2. Okay? So if I multiply by 2, here I have 6, here I have 6, and here I have 12. So let's remember that. Okay? So now let's go. So now we go to the actual proof. I call y of t equal u squared. And that's why I needed to assume that u was in L2, so that this makes sense. And y prime is 2 ut dt ut. This is clear. What's more interesting is the calculation of y double prime. And this is one of these virial identities that I was talking about last time. And there's this identity. And I can leave you to check that. It's nothing more than plugging in the equation and integrating by parts. Okay? So now I use now my inequality from below for 2 ut to the 6 that was in the previous slide. And so I still get this 2 ut squared. Now I get the 6. And here I had a 6 on this, but minus a 2 gives me a plus 4. And then I had the minus 12. Energy of W, and now I have some other positive constant. Okay, I just plugged it in. That's all I did. And now I add 2 plus 6, it gives me 8. And I remember that 3 times the energy is the gradient for W. So then I have the 4 minus 4, because 12 times is 3 times 4. Okay? And get that. And now remember that the gradient of ut squared remains strictly bigger than the gradient of w squared. So I'll throw it away. And I get this inequality from below. Okay? So assume that my interval of existence goes all the way to plus infinity. And I'm going to see that that cannot be. Then, you see, this function is strictly increasing. Y double prime is, y prime is strictly increasing. Y double prime is strictly positive. So y prime is strictly increasing, so eventually will become positive. It exists for all times. it will become positive, and then it will increase from that point on and remain positive. So there's certainly a T naught for which y prime is positive. So for t bigger than t naught, I multiply this inequality by y, which is u squared. And I forget the delta now. And I get this. But this we recognize from Cauchy-Schwarz that is bigger than twice y prime squared, because y prime is 2u dtu. And so when I look at this, I get y double prime over y prime is bigger than 2y prime over y. And I can do this because y prime never vanishes, because I showed that it was strictly positive for t bigger than t naught. But I know how to solve this ODE. This tells me that y prime is bigger than some constant times y squared. But that ODE blows up. So this cannot live for all time. Okay? So that's the argument. So if the energy is smaller than the energy of W and the gradient is bigger, it has to blow up. And I did it in the positive time direction, but in the negative it's the same. Okay. I think it's messing with me. Okay, so now the first thing is the heart of the matter in this theorem. So the first statement is that if the energy is smaller than the energy of W and the gradient is smaller than the gradient of W, the solution exists globally and scatters. Okay, so now we're going to develop a machine to prove that. This is not a few lines, okay? It'll take us until next time. I mean, not just today, but it will go on. Okay, but let's be patient and set it up. All right? The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to use my variational estimates. Okay? What do my variational estimates say? That if I start with data which is strictly smaller and the gradient is smaller, then for all time of existence, this remains small and this remains big. Okay, that was the variational estimates. But notice that this statement in particular implies that the energy is non-negative, because the energy has a 1/2 and a 1/6, and this has 1 and 1. Okay? Moreover, because of this lower bound, you can actually say that the energy is comparable to the H1 cross L2 norm at each time. Because the H1, the energy is certainly bounded by this, but by this lower bound, it's bounded from below by it. The ddt just sits there. Okay? And this is comparable to the initial H1 cross L2 norm. Why? Because the energy is constant. So this energy is the energy at time zero, and at time zero, this equivalence holds. So what is the situation then? The situation is my norm is under control. But that does not mean that my solution exists globally and scatters, because we have the examples of Krieger, Schlag, and Tataru that have this property but cease to exist in finite time. So we have to exclude that that happens. And this is, of course, non-trivial, because that happens by concentration. So we have to see that our size constraint excludes their example. Okay? Okay, so now I'm going to use the concentration compactness procedure. To use the concentration compactness procedure, I introduce the following statement. And I call it scattering, SC. Okay? For all U naught with H1 cross L2, such that the gradient is smaller than the gradient of W and the energy is smaller than the energy of W, then the corresponding solution is global and scatters. That's a statement that I would like to prove. S sub C. Okay? That's my theorem is SC is true. Okay? So now I'm going to say that the fixed function which verifies this hypothesis, the size constraints, we say that SC of U0, U1 holds if for this solution on its maximal interval, this L8 norm is finite. So that's the same as saying that the maximal interval is R and the solution scatters on both time directions. Okay? We saw that from the scattering criterion in terms of the space-time norm or the Strickert's norm being finite. So now we're going to start slowly. Yes?
U in C of I is finite uniformly in I.
No, I is the maximal interval. Okay? So I'm always using the maximal interval for I. Okay? So now I'm going to start. And I start by saying that if the data is small, certainly S sub C of U0, U1 holds by the local theory. Right? If I have small data, I showed, or I claimed, that the solution exists globally and scatters. Okay? But now I translate this in terms of the energy. If we're looking at data whose energy is smaller than the energy of W and gradient smaller than the gradient of W, the energy being small and the H1 cross L2 norm being small are equivalent. Okay? Because remember, we had this equivalence. Okay? So I know that there is some eta 0 positive such that if U0 verifies our hypothesis and its energy is really small, then scattering holds for this U0, U1. That's nothing more than a combination of variational estimates and small data theory. Okay. So what is my strategy? My strategy is to start increasing the energy. I'll start increasing the energy slowly until the first time that something goes wrong. And my goal is that first time is the level of energy of W. Okay? So that's the strategy. That's the concentration compactness procedure. Of course, this cannot be just done like this. I mean, one has to actually do some math, right? So I'm going to call E sub C the smallest level of energy. So E sub C will be a constant such that if U0, U1 verifies the hypothesis and the energy is strictly less than E sub C, then scattering holds. And I will look at the optimal E sub C with this property. Okay. And we know that this E sub C has to be strictly bigger than some number eta naught. And I'm only considering numbers smaller than or equal to the energy of W. Okay? So my goal, then, my theorem, is the statement E sub C equals the energy of W. If E sub C equals the energy of W, then my theorem is true. So I proceed by contradiction, and I assume that E sub C is strictly smaller than the energy of W. And then, if we're patient, we will reach a contradiction. But the contradiction comes after a very long time, okay? So bear with me. So this is the strategy. So we assume that E sub C is strictly smaller and we reach a contradiction. So the contradiction is reached because of the of three different events. So the first event is that there is an element in H1 cross L2 whose energy is the critical level of energy and therefore smaller than EW. Its gradient is smaller than the gradient of W, and the solution corresponding to it actually doesn't scatter. So this critical level of energy is realized by some function, the critical data. Okay? So that's the first thing to prove. The second thing to prove is that these critical functions, so these are very bad functions, right? They negate our theorem, so they're very bad functions. So the next statement is that these functions have a redeeming property. They're not all that bad. And what is the redeeming property? The redeeming property is a certain indecomposability of these functions. These functions cannot be torn apart. And that is precisely expressed in terms of the following mathematical statement, that you can find a scaling parameter lambda and a translation parameter x such that for such a critical function, let's say that the thing goes bad to the positive side. It either goes bad to the positive side or to the negative side. So let's assume it goes bad to the positive side. Of course, it could go bad for both, but that's even better. Then for on the positive side, we can find these modulations such that this thing behaves as if it were a single function, sort of as a singleton, so that there's a specific formula for this. And that means that the trajectory of this is compact. Of course, it's not a singleton, but the next best thing to being a singleton is being a compact set in this infinite dimensional space. Okay? So this is the redeeming feature. And this is a very non-dispersive property because it's easy to see that solutions of the it's a nonlinear statement because solutions of the linear equation, if they have this compactness property, they have to be zero. Okay? This is a simple fact. And then the third part, the rigidity theorem part, so this is kind of like a Liouville theorem. Right? So the Liouville theorem says, suppose you have a solution like this, verifying our size conditions, then the only possibility is that it be zero. Okay, so there can't be such an object with this nonlinear behavior. But this guy cannot be zero because its level of energy was the critical level of energy, and the critical level of energy was positive, was bigger than this eta naught. And that's the contradiction. So you have to wait quite a while to reach the contradiction. Okay? Okay. So in my notes I wrote a very detailed proof of this. But I then realized that I would bore everybody to tears if I gave this detailed proof. So instead of giving you a detailed proof, I'm going to give you the idea of why this is true. Okay? So let's start with the first, qualify that. The proofs of proposition A and proposition B are tedious. I'm sorry to say that. And lengthy and so on. And they use heavily the profile decomposition. But, so I'll sketch the idea for the proof of those and then give the complete proof of the rigidity theorem that says that there's no such object which is non-zero, okay? And that, I think, is kind of the the most important part of the proof. The other parts are easier to understand conceptually. Okay? So let me explain why proposition A is true. Okay? So how would we prove proposition A? I mean, what would be the most naive way of proving proposition A? So this is the critical level of energy. So if we go slightly higher than it, things will go very bad. So for each number n, there would be a function, a pair of size of whose energy is Ec plus 1 over n, such that the S norm would be infinite, by definition of being the critical level of energy, and the fact that it's strictly below the energy of W, so I can go a little bit above and still not reach the energy of W, so something has to go bad. If it goes bad, it means that the S norm is infinite. And then what you would do, if you are naive, is you would say, okay, now these are uniformly bounded functions, and let's pass to the limit. Of course, you cannot take a strong limit, but let's take a weak limit. And what happens if you try to do that in this naive way is that you fail, because you're at the critical level, and you cannot exchange weak conversions and nonlinearity when you're at the critical level of energy. So what you have to do is use the profile decomposition to substitute for this failure of compactness. Okay, so this makes complete sense. So what do you do? How do you use the profile decomposition? Okay, so now we take the profile decomposition of this sequence of functions. The first thing that you will observe is that for all these profiles, the energy is positive. Why is it positive? Because of the Pythagorean orthogonality conditions, the energy and the gradient will be smaller than the ones of W, and we know that if we are a certain amount smaller than W, then the energy remains positive. So all of these guys will have positive energy, as well as the remainder. The remainder will also have positive energy. So the next thing that you're going to show is that there cannot be more than one non-zero profile. Okay? Why is that? Well, suppose that there were two. Then if there are two, for each one of the profiles, I have to have that their energy is strictly smaller than EC. Because in the Pythagorean expansion, all the energies appear. The energy of the data of the U0n, U1n is going to EC, tending to EC. And if I have two blocks whose energy is non-zero, I can always subtract one of them. And then the other one, which remains on the right-hand side, will have energy strictly smaller than EC. Right? And I also have the gradient being strictly smaller than the gradient of W, because by my variational considerations, if the gradient is smaller and the energy is smaller, the gradient is smaller by a fixed amount. Okay. Of course, there's a slight problem with this argument here in that I cannot use the orthogonality, the Pythagorean expansion for just the space gradient. But this we overcome by the small fixing of it that I mentioned. So don't get stuck on this too long. But then each profile has energy strictly smaller than EC and gradient strictly smaller than the gradient of W. What does that mean about the profile? By the definition of EC, then the nonlinear solution exists globally and scatters. Then I can use my approximation theorem. Approximation theorem tells me that if each profile scatters, the sequence scatters. But that's a contradiction because they're picked to have infinite space Strickland's norm. So there can only be one non-zero profile. The next thing is, once we have only one non-zero profile, I will show that this remainder, these W's, that we know go to zero only in the dispersive norm, have to go to zero in H1 cross L2. And the argument for that is the same, because if those didn't go to zero in H1 cross L2, I could subtract their infimum, and then the one profile that I have would have to scatter, and that can't be. So those guys are now going to zero, and now my critical element is nothing more than the lonely profile that got left. Okay? So that's how I produce the critical element. Now, to show that this critical element, that I have the compactness property, that's the second thing, all I have to show is that I have a sequence of times tn converging to the final time. I can find scaling parameters and translation parameters such that when I modulate my solution, the corresponding thing converges in H1 cross L2. Okay? That's what I need to do. And how do I do that? Well, suppose that this doesn't happen and I produce a sequence of times in which it doesn't happen. Now I look at my critical element at that level of times and I look at its profile decomposition. The profile decomposition, again, can only have one non-zero profile by the same argument as before, and the remainder has to go to zero. Now, if you think about one non-zero profile, I undo the modulation in this non-zero profile and put it on the function, and then that's converging, and that gives me the compactness. Okay, so this is how this works. So you can consider proposition A and B proofs. Okay, so I'll show you now how the actual proof goes. It takes a while, you can see. Okay. Okay. So now we come to the rigidity theorem, and this I want to develop in more full detail. Okay. So the rigidity theorem says that if I have a compact object, a solution with this compactness property, and the energy is smaller than the energy of W, and the gradient is smaller than the gradient of W, then the only possibility is that it be zero. Okay? So this is what we have to do. By the way, as we continue with this, we will see that these solutions with the compactness property are essential in the theory. If you want to understand singularity formation for solutions which remain bounded in H1 cross L2, they are the bubbles. One can prove that any such solution bubbles off a compact object. And this is a very widely spread phenomenon. This is a statement that holds for basically any dispersive equation for which you have a profile decomposition. Okay, so there's this. So there are the basic bubbling objects. And then eventually you want a kind of rigidity theorem that says that these compact objects then have to be traveling wave solutions. And here what we're doing is we're being below the level of energy of the smallest elliptic solution. So if this philosophy is true, the only possibility is that the compact object be zero. Okay? So this is a tiny bit of confirmation of this philosophy. Okay? So this puts this in the framework of the larger thing that we're trying to do. Okay, of course, this was done 10 years ago, so we have to go up to now to be able to say these things. Okay? But this was a beginning towards this. All right. So the first thing that you need to think about, and this is a very subtle thing, you know, when you have this compact solution, the solutions with the compactness property, you just assume that there exists a function lambda of t and a function x of t with these certain properties. Now, what tells you that these functions are, let's say, measurable? Nothing. You have no knowledge of any property of this function except that they are a function. So the first step is to work a little bit to show that if you have them being some function, you can regularize them to be actually smooth functions before the final time of existence. And to do that, you work a little bit to make them piecewise constant functions, and then you kind of regularize the piecewise constant functions. I don't want to say more than that. Okay. So there, you can always assume, once you have the functions that may be, you know, kind of crazy functions, you can always transform them into continuous or regular functions. Okay. I don't know why it keeps... I think it doesn't like me today. Okay. Okay, the next lemma is also a lemma I'm not going to prove, but I'll tell you why this is true. Okay? The lemma tells me that if I have a critical element, I can always manufacture another critical element for which the lambda is strictly positive. Okay? So why is this true? I'll explain it in words and gestures. Okay. Suppose that I'm given one critical element, which is bad, and the lambda goes to zero as I approach the final time. Yes.
So a stupid question. Lambda bounded from below means the thing cannot concentrate or cannot spread.
It cannot concentrate. Or spread, I don't know, which, you know, cannot spread. But we have this difficulty that sometimes we call it lambda and then others 1 over lambda. And then, you know, in different papers it's lambda and in others are 1 over lambda, and we always confuse ourselves. But what I'm saying also applies to 1 over lambda being bounded from below. So you can always assume one or the other as you may find it convenient, but not both at the same time.
In words, it's clear.
Yes. Okay, so what's the proof of this? Suppose this fails. Then you have your critical element and the lambda is going to zero as you approach the final time. Okay? But you have the compactness property, and so your solution, after you modulate it, has a limit as you approach the final time. And now you reverse the time from the final time. And then your lambda that was going to zero now is going to rise as you go in the opposite time direction. And that's how it's going to be big. Right? If it was going down as I went this way, when I go this way, it goes up. And that's all there is to it. And all these convergences work by the compactness. Okay? So we'll just assume this. And you can see in the notes there's this very careful proof. Now I'm going to go to, and I'm now going to stop waving my hands and do more specific proofs. The first thing is, suppose I have a critical element and the time is finite. So we're in the finite time case. And of course, after scaling, we can assume it's one, the final time. Then this lambda not only becomes big, but in fact it goes to infinity as a lower bound by 1 over 1 minus t. Okay? And this is a very general property that just has to do with the fact that the compactness property holds and the homogeneity of the problem. If you were working with a Schrödinger instead of wave, you would have square root instead of 1 minus t. If you were working with KdV, you would have the one-third power, and so on. Okay? So let me show the proof of this. So you only need to consider Tn going to 1. And we look at un of 0 to be this object, which is our modulated solutions. Okay? Now we know that the UNs, this UNs of zero, form a compact set. And if you remember, a corollary of the perturbation theorem was that when I start with a compact set, I get uniform time of existence. Okay? So the solutions corresponding to this data have uniform time of existence. Okay? They exist until a time C0, which is uniform in N. All right? Now, this Y1 shouldn't be there. It's a typo. So I'm now going to take our critical element and write it in this way, so that I can tell you what the solution corresponding to this thing is in terms of the solution corresponding to that. So as long as I'm before the final time of existence, we get that the UNs modulated in the reciprocal way give me the critical solution. Okay, this is just the uniqueness in the Cauchy problem. Because this will be a solution, and at time zero it's exactly this, and this equals that, and the solution with that data will be this. Okay? So it's just a uniqueness. But so the time of existence is bigger than C naught, at least C naught. I'm sorry. Yeah, it's bigger than C naught. So as long as this is smaller than C naught, this exists. So this exists. So this must be less than 1, because 1 is the last time for which this solution exists. So therefore, this is less than 1 whenever this is less than that. And I plug in t to be the ratio of c0 over lambda t naught, and I solve, and I get my lower bound. Right, this is the compactness gives us a uniform time of existence, and then you just use how the problem works. So we have a lower bound. The next thing that we're going to prove is that the compactness shows also that if we have finite time of existence, we have the inverted light cone picture. The solution lives there. Outside is just simply zero. That's what we're going to prove, because of the compactness property. If it lives in finite time, it has to concentrate at the point. Okay? Okay, so how do we prove this? Okay. The first thing we're going to use is a property of finite speed of propagation. So if we have data which is controlled, and we know that at time zero, the tail is a certain amount small for all further times, this thing is small. And the way you do it is you truncate your solution to look like the other one at the tail, and then it will coincide with it outside by finite speed of propagation, and the one that is like this, you make it completely small by filling it inside the hole.
Stupid question. The term u squared over x squared, where does it come from?
It's from Hardy's inequality.
Yes,
yeah,
sure. But,
So it's always controlled.
You put it for convenience.
Yeah, well, to take care of the cutoffs when I differentiate the cutoff. That's all I'm doing. But it's important to note that I have this Hardy term always at my disposal, because that's controlled by the H1 dot norm. N is bigger than or equal to 3 here. Okay? And this I will be using it constantly, so it's a good thing to keep it in mind. Okay? So we always have this can be made small, and therefore this can be made small. So now to carry out this proof, the first step is to show that this limit as t goes to 1 is 0. Okay. So how do you do that? This is nothing more than the compactness of this modulo modulations, of this collection of functions, together with the fact that the lambda tends to infinity as t tends to 1. We saw that the lambda tends to infinity as t tends to 1 because it's bigger than 1 over 1 minus t. And that goes to infinity as t tends to 1. And therefore, what happens when you look at the tail like that, the lambda pushes the tail outside, and because of the compactness, the thing goes to 0. Okay, the tails are uniformly small for compact objects. So this limit is always 0. Now I have to see what do I do with this thing, the x of t over lambda of t. Okay, so this is what I have to first control to be able to get the point x bar. So because this expression at time s was small, I can use finite speed of propagation going backwards in time, and I get that this thing is small for any s. Right? I start with something small, then I go backwards in time, and then it will have to be small. And the point is that this implies that this guy's always have to remain bounded. Because if they don't remain bounded, this thing will go to infinity, let's say for a sequence, but then eventually this will be contained in that, tn goes to 1, this is going to infinity, so outside of infinity I get any ball that I want, and then I let s be 0 here, and I pass the limit in n, and I get that for any ball, this is 0, But that can't be because my solution was not zero. Because it's a critical element, so its space-time norm is infinite. So it can't be zero. So that already shows me that x of t over lambda t is bounded. And then for some sequence tending to 1, I have an x bar. So I found the center now. Just by the simple properties of finite speed of propagation. Now, once I found the center, for n large, this is going to minus x bar. And then for any eta not fixed, for n large, is this inclusion holds for any for an R naught, for an R naught that may depend on eta naught. And with this, I see by that inclusion that for any S, this thing is zero for any eta naught positive. And that gives the support property. Okay, at level S, it has to be contained in the ball of radius 1 minus S around X bar. So the picture is really that in the finite blow-up case. Okay. The next thing is a fundamental property of critical elements. Now, the energy critical wave equation has one more constant of motion, and that's the momentum. Okay? That's this fact. For any t, this equality holds. And how do you check that? Well, you differentiate in t, and you see that it's zero by the equation. Okay? And the next property, and this is a crucial property for us, is that if you have a critical element and you prepare it properly, you make the x and the lambda continuous, and either t plus is finite, or if it is infinite, you make it bounded below. Okay, so that spreads out. Then you can prove that the momentum has to be zero. So that means that in a way, the compact object is not moving very much. Okay, so this is something to be proved. And I think I have enough time to sketch the proof of this. The proof of this is not short, okay, but I'll sketch it. So we will exploit the Lorentz invariance for this. Okay, so Lorentz transformations play a role. So assume the momentum is not zero, then one component of the momentum is non-zero. We might as well assume that this is positive. Okay? The first component is non-zero. If it's negative, we change the sign of x1 into minus x1. Okay? So we can always assume that it's positive. And let's first consider the t plus. And let's say that t plus is 1, which is without loss of generality. And we recenter the solution so that this x bar is now the origin, the x bar that we found in the previous lemma. Okay. Now it's more convenient here to consider u of xt is 1 plus t and that t equals 0 be the tip of the cone. So let's make it this t equals 0. Okay. And now, because it's the first component of the momentum that's non-zero, we do the Lorentz transform of our solution in the first coordinate direction with a parameter L that we're going to choose to be very small. Okay? So we have our new solution. And then it's easy to see that this still solves the nonlinear wave equation for time, let's say, bigger than minus a half, and that the support is still inside the cone. Okay, this is just a simple geometric fact. Now, what's the point of this? The point is that when we look at this solution, let's say at time... Yes.
Minus 1/2 is uniform in L?
For L small.
For L small.
We're only going to look at L very small. Okay? Yes. So now we're going to look at the derivative of the energy as a function of L, as L goes to zero. And the point is that the derivative of the energy is the negative of the momentum. Okay, this is a general fact. You do the Lorentz transform, you differentiate that in the Lorentz parameter, and you get the negative of the momentum. And you can check it by hand. So, but now this is negative. And then the other thing that happens is that the gradient for some t0 remains small. Now, why do we just have to pick some t0? Because we calculated by doing the integration in space and time, which we can undo by the Lorentz transformation. Space-time integrals you can undo by the Lorentz transformation. And if one was small, the other one is small. And then you can pick a time at which it is small. Because if the integral is small, or the average of the integral is small, there is a time at which it is small. Okay? But then, the ZL has energy smaller than the energy of W, gradient smaller than the gradient of W for L small, and therefore exists globally and scatters. But that contradicts its support, contradicts where it lives. And that's what we gained by the energy being strictly, you see, the energy falls from the energy of UC. Becomes less than the critical level of energy. So if the momentum is non-zero, then you can decrease the energy by doing a Lorentz transformation. And therefore you reach a contradiction. So the only thing that could have happened is that momentum is zero. So it's a property of critical elements. Now in the infinite time case, the calculation is a bit more complicated, but the principle is the same. So I'll skip the infinite time case. Okay? But you see that we're building properties of these critical elements so that when we prove the rigidity theorem, we have more things at our disposal. That's the story. Okay, so I think for today we can stop here and then we'll continue on Friday. Thank you.